如果他也有我的天堂做人心里修上去阿们是老母可能
是老母
OK So I know one person got to file that I sent out today
You can do more
You know, we can do more for 3 weeks
I
realize that because that's only one third of it. There's a whole bunch in the file. I just wanted you to have what we've already done. I'm trying to get it printed up, kind of poster size, so I can hang it here in a week, or maybe hang it on the wall or something. I don't know. What we're talking about is I sent out a file today. Who saw it? About three people.
No more.
It's basically the sort of the menorah that we talked about last week and the week before. Who remembers what it's called? The seven
world week.
It's called the world week, and that is an ancient Jewish concept about the age of man, sort of the timeline of prophecy, if you will. So I printed all that out, or I sent it to you so you could print it out. I will have it printed. So last week we kind of went over the spiritual side of that menorah and looked at how the seven spirits of Elohim kind of line up with, not last week, the week before. Kind of line up with each of those seven 1,000 year periods. So I guess I need to. I'm just a slave to this diagram, it seems. Who remembers what these two periods are called? Former meeting and latter meeting. Former meeting first. Okay, so we have established, I think we're all pretty convinced that we're in the last days, right?
Yes.
Okay, so I think I haven't spent any time convincing anyone that we're there. Where did we benchmark the beginning of the last days?
2,000 years ago.
Roughly 2,000 years ago, someone said to Peter, yes, Caiaphas preached the first gospel message, and he, through the Spirit, through the Ruach of Elohim, basically prophesied saying, we're there. Because it was said, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. And so the last days began right here, which is at the end of day 4, beginning of day 5. So these, the latter rain, are the last days, right? And if there is a biblical reference to these, I would call it Kedem. Kedem, which means antiquity, ancient days. Okay. So we're in the last days. So that's what we're going to start doing tonight, is zooming in on the last days. Remember, I told you we're gonna start broadly, and we're going to start zooming in. We're going to eventually get down to a single day. And I'm talking a single 24-hour period. Okay? But, so we have kind of summarized all of this over the last couple of weeks. So if you need the details, go ahead and watch the two videos. So we're going to start zooming into here. And when we started, who remembers one of the first scriptures that I brought up when we started this study about Abba and his perspective on all of this?
Anybody remember?
No? One verse. It's one verse that kind of summarizes Abba's perspective on this. He sees the end from the beginning. Remember that? So, and I've taught this before. We talk about it, I wouldn't say frequently, but periodically it comes up. The infinite nature, I mean, his name, this is kind of sloppy. Let me kind of fix it here. His very name implies or states that he is outside of time, right? Who was and is and will be. Time doesn't trap him in a box like it does us. He's outside of our time bubble that we're in. Our universe is confined by time and space. Okay? He's not confined by that. So he's the author and finisher of it. He's the one who set it in motion. He's the programmer. He knows how all the possibilities of how it could have worked out, and he knows how it worked out. Right? It's a big God. So he looks back. We have to look back in the past, and I'm a historian, and I love looking back at the past, and I wish I could do what Abba does. He knew the past before it was the past. I mean, that's just mind-boggling. So he has pulled certain prophets out of our bubble of time and shown them his perspective. That's effectively what he did, especially with Yochanan, the one who wrote Hidgalut, the book of Revelation, which literally means pulling back the curtain. And I believe that fabric that he's talking about is time. So he reached in there, pulled him out, stuck him on the other end of it, and said, this is what's going to happen in the last days. Okay, so, but I told you, we're going to narrow down eventually on that little sector. Remember that? What's it called?
Etkes.
Etkes. time of the end. Okay? So, but for now, our zoom in is from here to here. From the beginning of day 5 to the end of day 7. Really, I mean, we're going to look at this as well, but really right now we're focused on these two. But what are the last days? Out of 7 days, what are the last ones? 5, 6, and 7, right? Okay. That's a little broad for the bottom. Okay. So, question so far. What's this called again?
World Week.
Okay. One of the reasons that I believe that this is so overlooked in theology, for one, it's a Jewish thing. And Western theologians kind of despise Jewish people and Jewish theology and Jewish ideas. So they just throw it away. Okay. That's why we haven't looked at it in 2000 years as believers in Messiah. One of the reasons that I believe that this is the model is because of its antiquity, the age of this idea. It goes all the way back before Messiah. And so others brought up, I believe you and some brought up the verse, a day unto Yahweh is 1,000 years, 1,000 years are a day. Kepha, Peter quotes that when he's talking about the last days and he's talking about people starting to disobey. We're going to look at that because we're in the last days, and that's what we're about to look at. So that's one of the scriptures that we're going to look at is the behaviors. Because I believe the behaviors of people are one of the major, major indicators as to being in the last days, and certainly where we are, which is somewhere in here. I believe we're on this side of this line, but maybe not that far. we could be extremely close. Okay? So no questions, so we'll plot on. So he sees the end from the beginning. So turn to Genesis chapter 49. Bereshit. Mem-tet. Vayikra Yaakov el Banav. Now. Yes. Somebody went, Isn't that interesting? Vayikra. Huh?
On the Sabbath,
That is why you cry, not self-familiar to you?
Yeah.
And he called, yeah, but it's the name of the book of Leviticus, which is the book of holiness.
Where
are you going? Vayikra Yaakov el Banav. And Jacob called to his sons, his children, Vayomer. Okay. I'm going to read this slowly again because here is a key word in studying last things. Okay. Vayikra Yaakov el Banav Vayomer. And Yaakov called to his sons and said, here's the word. He'asfu. He'asfu. I'll put it on the board.
Genesis 49.
I started in verse 1.
Okay. Did you hear the 4? That's what we heard.
This, remember, Hebrew words all have usually a 3-letter root, some of them a 2-letter root, but a 3-letter root. It's these three letters, asaf, which means to gather together. Okay, did I spell something wrong? So the front and the back are just conjugation of that verb into plural and sort of, I forget the technical name of that tense, but it's being done to people and it's plural. Okay? But the middle is what we need to talk about is asaf. And so that is a word that you usually see associated with future end time assembly of the nations, bringing together the people of Elohim. It's called, the word is to gather together, to add to. Okay, so you're going to see that. You're going to see that quite a bit in some of the verses that we are going to hit in talking about some events that are in our very near future. Yeah.
Okay, so you can like pare it down to a lower level and to soap.
To what? So the end, yes. What she's talking about is if you go to a two-letter root, that's it, it means the end. Okay? So you'll find there are linguistic hints like this all over scriptures, and I don't believe any of them are coincidental. Okay. He'asku v'agida lachem et asher yikra etchem be'achrit hayamim. I'm going to go slow. Gather yourselves together, and I will tell you, I will declare to you, et asher. Okay? I don't know how deep into this, into the Hebrew we want to go here, but here's a little picture of Messiah, okay? Et asher, et is the Aleph and the Tav. He said, I am the Aleph and the Tav. Et asher yikra etchem. Now that is very interesting, because it says in the English translation, befall you in the last days. Okay, so let me finish this. Et asher yikra etchem be'acharit hayamim. In the last days. That's the phrase that gave us the name for these last 3 days. Acharit Hayamim, the last days. So let me set context here. This is Yaakov, whose name was changed to Israel. He's called his 12 sons, the fathers of the 12 tribes of Israel, together because he's about to die and he is prophesying over them. And it's not about their immediate short-term future. It's about the very end of time. Okay? And their role in it, kind of their place in it. Okay? You can say, now keep that in mind when you read this prophecy, that you're watching for what events happen from here to here in this prophecy. That's a benefit we have that the sons of Israel did not have, right? Okay. But what he says is, et asher yikra etchem. I'm going to show you, I'm going to reveal to you what will be called upon you in the last days. Yeah.
Because the word to read also is cut off.
Correct.
So you're reading out of a book.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yep. We will try not to go into all this so-level stuff, but it's hard for some of us.
But if you care to go fast, and it's on video.
Yeah. Be'acharit hayamim. So that's sort of our key phrase here. So we have, gather yourselves together, and I will show you what will be called upon you, be'acharit hayamim. All right. And he says to Reuben, you are my firstborn, my strength, and my initial vigor, foremost in rank and foremost in power. Water-like impetuosity. You can be foremost because you mounted your father's bed. You cannot be foremost because you mounted your father's bed, and you desecrated him who ascended my couch. Now he's talking about something that did happen in their lifetime. Right? Reuben went up to his father's wife and violated, you know, basically committed incest. Okay? So what did that mean? That means he could not be the one to inherit the blessing. He could not be the one to become the high priest of the tribe, if you will. So he was demoted for that. But the reason this has implications in the last days is because of the tribe that is chosen through whom the Messiah will come. Because had Reuben not done that, then it would have, Messiah would have come through Reuben. Are you with me? But Messiah did not come through Reuben. All right? Shimon and Levi are comrades. Their weaponry is a stolen craft. Into their conspiracy may my soul not enter. With their congregation, do not join. Oh, my honor, for in their rage they murdered people, and at their whim they hamstrung an ox. Accursed is their rage, for all its intents. For it is intense, and their wrath, for it is harsh. I will separate them within Yaakov, and I will disperse them in Israel. What's the practical living out of that? What happened?
Well, they went and killed all of the, raped the, they didn't, I guess, the tribe that had their way with, I think it's Dina, right?
Dina. That's right. They took advantage of men and tricked them into circumcising themselves, and while they were in their pain, they murdered them. And they brought shame on Israel because of it.
The tribe that they murdered with the people? Anybody remember?
Shechemites.
Their heart was for God. That they did that. They were willing to join.
They did it.
And that's what my question is, did they, by circumcising them, did they actually brought them into the...
Yeah, they were part of it.
And then they murdered them.
Yeah. So, and don't think that's a unique thing, because people have been doing it, you know. Christians have murdered Christians all the time, you know. Throughout the last 1700 years of history, people have been killing for no reason. Killing so-called brothers, you know, just because they believe differently than that.
If you dig a little deeper into the ages, there's some interesting things. In Genesis 37, Joseph is 17 years old. Dina's a little older. So we think, you know, she's going to be 17, 19. But that story about Shechem is, if you check this earlier, and, well, Hamas has comments, but basically Dina could have been 9 or 10 or 11. And then that puts Levi and Simeon at age 13 or so. And of course, some of that speculation
about
Jasher.
It's hard to pin down. So how does this apply? What does this do for these two guys? They're disqualified as well. They were next in line. So Messiah can't come through Shimon, and Messiah cannot come through Levi, because they were next in the sequence, but they committed grave unrighteousness. And here's the key: they did not repent. We're about to see that. Okay? And this is what we're about to read then is sort of the result of, to me, one of the most beautiful stories in the book of Genesis. We'll go over that here in a second. So let's start in 8. Yehuda, and this is what we're driving at. Remember, this is the last days that we're talking about. So we disqualified three tribes from being the Messianic tribe. And remember the whole book, Genesis. Remember Genesis 1, verse 1? The first 7 words are a prophecy about the Messiah. This whole book is about the coming of the Messiah. Okay, and everything that happened to Israel is to foretell the coming of the Messiah. All right, so Yehuda, verse 8. You, your brother, shall acknowledge your hand will be at your enemy's neck. Your father's sons will prostrate themselves to you. A lion cub is Yehuda. From the prey, my son, you elevated yourself. He crouches, lies down like a lion, and like an awesome lion, who dares to rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a scholar from among his descendants, until Shiloh arrives. and his will be an assemblage of nations. He will tie his donkey to the vine branch, his donkey's foal. He will launder his garments in wine, and his robe in the blood of grapes, red-eyed from wine, and white-toothed from milk. This is the one that brings us straight into the last days. We're going to go look at some of the other prophecies that point that out. So why is it? Did Yehuda do something that was just as bad as the other three brothers ahead of him?
Yes.
In fact, worse. Right? Not only did he participate in selling out Yosef, right? But he slept with his son's wife.
Worse, he did not obey the command to let the
Levirate
have the children.
That's right. So, yes. So his son took a wife and died. And he had another son who was very, very young. But according to the Torah, this is what tells us that the Torah existed in the book of Genesis. This is another thing that says that the commandments of Elohim existed in the book of Genesis, because we only see that command when we get to Exodus, Numbers, and Leviticus, and Deuteronomy, where we are commanded, Israelites are commanded, that if a son, if a brother should leave, die before he conceives, before he bears children, that his brother takes that wife and bears children for him. They will be his sons, the dead man's sons, right? You get what I'm driving at? This is proof that the demands existed before they were written down, right? And he didn't follow that command. His youngest son was not given to the wife, and she was waiting for the commandment to take effect. She was waiting for the other brother, because back then, finding a husband or a wife today is hard? Try it on the plains of Cana. When you're looking for a righteous person to marry, it was difficult to find a husband for a woman back then, right? Especially one who had already been married. But she had one, and he wasn't given to her, so of course her name was Tamar, and she tricked Yehuda and brought him into her bed, right? And he went in willingly, which was against Torah as well, because he was a married man, right? So she confronts him afterward, and you know, she's got proof that he was in her bed. You know the story, most of you know the story. Yeah, he left his ring and his staff, so which were basically ID cards back then. So he left his driver's license.
Left his sheep driver's license.
But what happened? He repented. He repented of that. She is more righteous than I. And then, even more beautiful than that, when the brothers sell out Yosef, and 20 some odd years later, what is it, 21 years later, they are revealed. He is revealed to them. It's Yehuda that breaks down and asks Yosef for forgiveness. Right? He shows contrition. He shows his ability to let go of his pride, admit when he's wrong, and basically take on the sins of his brothers.
If you will.
So, it is hard to do, but Yehuda did it, and so that is why, you know, this is what is beautiful. The picture here is beautiful because he didn't qualify, but I would qualify it because of his repentance, because of his contrition. Are you with me? And that's the only reason any of us qualify is because we become contrite before him. That's the only reason that he brings us into his kingdom. Okay, so let's look at this. A lion cub is Yehuda. From the prey, my son, you elevated yourself. What do you think that's a picture of? But in what sense?
Say again.
From the prey, my son, you elevated yourself.
I think, from what I can see, during the time of Yeshua, being a picture of Yeshua, he was above all the ones that were following their own doctrine he wrote above, and then doctrine said, said what God's word was.
Okay. Anything else?
Well, he took on this flesh, and he elevated himself by the Torah. He's as well as elevating God elevating him out of Sheol.
There you go. There you go.
He's the old one who's even that.
Yeah. So, yeah, so you have a lion who is lying down. You elevated yourself from the prey. What are the prey? The people who pursue you. Who pursued Yeshua? Hasatan. Mm-hmm. Right? Wanted to kill him, wanted to destroy him, pursued him all the way in the shield. Okay? But he came back. And here he's called Bani, my son. When a prophecy is going on and you hear the word Bani, my son, you can almost bet it's about Yeshua and not the person that it's talking about. Okay? So I do believe that this is a foreshadowing of Yeshua and his resurrection. And then there's the second part of that. He crouches, he lies down like a lion, and like an awesome lion, who dares to rouse him? And then it says, the scepter shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a scholar. And I want to read that. Who says something else? A lawgiver, right? Is it Mehokeki? Is that what it says? Mehokeki.
Yeah. Should be Shevet.
Well, hang on. Shevet is the staff. Mehokeki is a lawgiver. Okay? So, we talked about this in our study of Deuteronomy. What is a chok? It is a command, but it's not explained, right? We're not given a reason why we're told to do it, we're just to do it, right? It usually has prophetic it's usually very prophetic, usually pointing to the Messiah in some way. What is the biggest quote that you can think of? I have one in my mind. It's a Torah command that we no longer do, we can't do it. We're about to do it, or Israel is about to do it again. The red heifer. Red heifer is an unexplained command. Okay? But Israel has for the last, 30 years been trying to breed the perfect red heifer. And they've done it once or twice over the last 30 years. And recently they've done it. Somewhere. No. This was up in Maine or Vermont or
somewhere. U.S.
There have been several episodes of it. There was one in Tennessee some years ago that I heard Joseph take.
Mississippi.
Yeah, but recently some rabbis flew from Israel to inspect one, and I believe it was up in the Northeast somewhere. Okay, and it qualified. So, what am I getting at? This is a chok. This is a mysterious command that we don't understand why we do it, but we do it because he said it to him. Right? Okay, and that's what you have here, Mehokek. That's the one who creates a statute, if you will. Mehok is a statute. Mehokek. Me makes it a noun, so it's a lawgiver. And that's how it's translated. Whose translation has that? Lawgiver. Sorry.
I was just curious of what the game is, or what are they doing?
Okay, so when the Beit HaMikdash is built, before any service, before anything goes on in it, it has to be sanctified by the ashes of a red heifer. Both the one that Moshe, they found it 20-some-odd years ago. They found the ashes of the red heifer. They were buried away on the Temple Mount somewhere, I think, or somewhere, maybe Elijah's cave. I can't remember where they found it. But they have to have the original ashes of the red heifer, the ashes from the second temple, and the ashes of a today's effort in order to sanctify the next temple.
Okay.
So Israel has been breeding heifers to get to the point where when it's time to build the temple, they'll have one on hand.
Okay.
And you can't even have a single white hair. It has to be completely crimson red. Okay. So that what I'm driving at is that is a type of command. So a mehokek is someone who litigates a lawgiver. All right, and of course, we're told in the Brit Chadashah that we will be judged by the Torah, that Yeshua will judge all human beings by his Torah, which is the law. Okay, so he will look at the Torah, use the wisdom that Elohim has given him, and judge the person who is standing in front of him, right? So that's the part, and so I preached on the Shevet. Shevet. This past Shabbat, I believe it was. Okay, so I'm not going to go into that too much. But here, the scepter, that's the scepter. So he has the scepter, which means what? He's the one who is going to rule his brothers. This is a messianic prophecy. This is a prophecy that the Messiah would come through Yehuda. And we know that's the case. See, again, we have the benefit of all this looking back, hindsight knowledge that we have because we're up here. And in Israel, when Israel started, after their first king, who was an idiot, David becomes king, and Elohim gives him prophecy that through you the Messiah will come. Through you. And what tribe is David from? Judah. He descends directly from Judah. Okay. Thoughts or comments?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, just kind of, it says the staff or the scepter's not going to depart from Judah, nor the lawgiver from between his feet.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on with the feet here?
Well, what did Abba say when he will make, he said, Abba said he's going to make something a footstool for his feet.
Oh, his enemies are going to.
There you go.
Well, why is it between his feet?
Isn't that where a scepter sits?
Not a scepter, the okay. Am I reading it wrong?
No, you're not. But I think it's in reference to both.
Okay, it's just the imagery? It's an imagery?
Yeah, I believe it's imagery, but it, I mean, if you consider the whole throne.
Okay.
Are you there now?
Yeah,
okay.
That's, that's a waste of word. I don't know.
Yeah, it's hard. It's a legitimate question. Yeah. I didn't see it as a question just because I'm seeing the whole throne when I see this. Okay. Fine.
I get the imagery of red eyes from one. But the white tooth from milk, I'm not getting the symbolism of.
Okay, we're gonna look at that here in a minute. And I'm not sure I'll be able to answer that question tonight, but maybe. Okay? Because we're gonna go look at the scriptures that this is foreshadowing here in a minute. I wanna talk about until Shiloh comes. Okay? So the scepter will not depart from his feet, nor a law from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. Let me find that in the Hebrew. What verse are we in?
10.
Verse 10. Lo yasur shevet mi Yehuda mechokek. The point that, let me go ahead and clarify what Deanne asked and what my answer was. His feet, I believe, is Abba's feet. Everybody pick up on that? It's one throne. Abba sits on it. Yeshua stands beside it. Right? At his right hand. Okay. Ad ki yavo Shiloh. Ad ki yavo Shiloh. Until. If, I'm going to read this literally and then we'll unmess it up. Until, if, or when, Yavo, Shiloh. This is translated as Shiloh, and there's 9 million Shiloh Baptist Church in the South. Right?
Yes.
What does Shiloh mean? The one who is his.
Has a baby, that's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is that also the area where James Lazarus was probably?
I don't think so.
That was Bethel.
Bethel.
Okay. Velo yikahet amin. Osri la gethet ira. Okay, let me switch back to English. He will tie his donkey to the vine branch his donkey's foal. How was that? Where did we see that?
In
the triumphal entry. The triumphal entry. When Yeshua came into Yerushalayim, he made a prophecy. He told a couple of his Talmidim, go into the city, you'll see a donkey tied to a post. Tell them that it's for me, and they will let him come. So they do exactly that, and they bring him in. Okay, so Yeshua comes into the city, and what most of us don't understand is that, and this is roughly 2,000 years after this prophecy was made, that Yeshua is fulfilling this. And by the time Yeshua is fulfilling it, it had become custom that a king whose kingdom is at peace comes in on a donkey and not on a horse. A horse is a warrior. Okay? So you can hardly ride a donkey in battle. So it's a symbol that Yeshua came to bring peace. Okay? Now that conflicts with one thing that he said, but that's different. It's just a different side of it, right? Okay, but he came into the city riding on a donkey, which was symbolic that he was king, and that's why people were laying palm fronds in front of him, which is also what you do for royalty. Okay, so they were treating him as their king when he came into the city. All right.
Could I ask a clarification?
What?
Could I ask about a clarification?
Maybe.
Okay, I'm just going to preface this with I'm pretty sure I'm wrong, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be Talmudic. However, this is why I'm asking. Not my clarification, yours. You're the historian. There is supposedly.
Look at my back.
Get back. Bring it. I've been on the road all day. I'm ready. Supposedly, there's a teaching from the sages of old. The Messiah would come, he would come twice, the city of peace was ready for him to be received, he was going to ride in on the white stallion, if he were not ready, he was going to ride in on the donkey. And this prophecy for us for Messiah is, he did ride in on the donkey, but in compliance with that prophecy of old from the sages that they supposedly teach, that would have been the first, and they still don't want to see it. The first arrival.
Well, that's possibly rooted in something more ancient than Talmud, so you have a pass. Because what was going on in the time of Messiah is, and I think we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, but there was the idea that there were two different Messiahs. Okay? Not the same guy. There was debate going on. Okay? And so the Essenes, and I believe that Yohanan HaMatbil was an Essene. That's a small sect of Jews who lived in the time of Messiah, and I believe they wrote the Qumran Scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls. Okay? Which, by the way, they have a book of Isaiah that predates time of Messiah, because a lot of people think that Isaiah was written post-Messiah and that it was backward, sort of retrofitted to say all the things that it says. And that's garbage. Okay, so, but the Essenes believed that there were two Messiahs. They believed in Messiah ben Yosef and Messiah ben David, but they did not know which would come first. And so you see this doctrine arise when Yohanan HaMatbil, John the Baptist, sends his Talmidim, his disciples, to the Messiah and says, are you the Messiah or should we expect another? And of course, Yeshua basically answers the question with a statement. He doesn't directly answer the question yes or no. He says, go back and tell Yohanan what you see.
Which even that unto itself, isn't that uncharacteristic of a rabbi? No. If they normally answer
Jewish. I did that as a teacher long before I knew I was Jewish. I got in trouble in the Navy. I got in trouble in the Navy for starting, I was learning to teach in instructor school.
Yeah.
And the guy failed me because I asked about 6 questions at the beginning of the lesson. He thought I was trying to reach my question goal, you know, because we were supposed to ask like 6 or 7 questions during the lesson. He thought I was trying to get them all out of the way up front.
Then why do you get on to me?
Because you tread in places we don't need to tread. All right, so hang on. So yes, there is a concept, was a concept, that there were 2 messiahs, Messiah ben Yosef, who was a suffering servant, okay, and Messiah ben David, who was a conquering king. And so Yeshua answers the question and basically tells Yohanan to put your mind at rest because it's one and the same. Okay,
there can be only one.
So he basically says, I am he. Okay?
At that point, like the horse and the donkey really had nothing to do with it, as far as what his answer was. That was the point that I want clarification. Like, that was my question, was how did the animals play into that understanding of the prophecy? Because we say that the stuff isn't in there for no reason. Well, and it's pointed out specifically, he rode in on a donkey, so we've got to be
reading. Obviously, the conquering king does come riding in on a white horse. Yeah. Obviously, the king of peace comes in riding on a donkey, so it was in there.
Okay.
It just wasn't in the conversation that Yeshua had. Because it's obvious which does what.
Well, yeah.
Okay? And the book of Revelation proves it because he is specifically coming back on a white horse. And my hope is that I will be on behind him on my own white horse.
So I have another question about that, because I didn't know about that one. So I'm sitting here looking at the Revelation one, and when he's coming back in halves.
That's right.
That's a war thing.
That's right.
So is there a donkey reference in Daniel that's like maybe in the after he's
Daniel's prediction is about his first coming.
First coming. Right.
Okay.
So he's the beast.
So it's kind of like an exchange.
So what's going on here, hopefully this will help everybody, and you have to, when you're studying prophecy, you have to keep this in mind. I haven't said this yet. I think I have, but not obviously, but you have to keep this in mind. In order to understand all of this, let me make some room first. This is all on that chart that I emailed today. And I might try to get it printed on some, you know, maybe 30 copies on some smaller stuff. I don't know. So we're looking at this world week, and it's all already been established. This is going to happen just like Allah knows it's going to happen. We can't change it. Okay? And he's already shown multiple prophets, multiple pieces of all of this. So you have Daniel, who came right about here. I'm just going to put a dalet for Daniel. Okay? You have Yeshayahu and Yirmiyahu and Yehezkiel right here. In that order, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, their names all start with a yod. Okay? And of course, you have Yaakov back here. Right here. And these guys are getting pieces and parts of all of this stuff. Do you get what I'm driving at? Let me get another color. So Daniel is going to say some things about this. He's going to say some things a lot about that. In one single book. Are you with me? All 3 of these guys are going to do the same thing. They all look to here. They're all pointing to the Messiah's first coming. They're pointing to things that are going to happen during the time that is right before us during the time that we're in, during Et Ket, and all the way out to here, all in three little books, three different books. So when you read Daniel, it's nothing in prophecy is linear. And this is, I think I brought up that verse. It is the glory of Elohim to conceal a matter. It's the glory of kings to seek it out. Our job is to look at it and not, you know, not to look at it with bias. You know, I stopped listening to prophets, modern day prophets. I stopped reading their, the only guy, if you haven't figured it out, the only guy I respect in the book printing world of prophecy is Joseph Good. He's the only one. And I'm not saying he's perfect. I disagree with him on some things. But he takes this approach. Okay? And he doesn't just randomly pick something out and create a whole idea about it. He takes a broad approach to the whole thing. He studies all of these pieces and parts. So Daniel prophesies not only about the coming of Messiah the first time, but also here. And really, if you look at Daniel, he prophesies about this whole thing in one place. Okay? So you have to be judicious at what you're looking at and whether or not it's relating to what is immediately around it.
Well, of course, the primary nature of Scripture, when Yeshua gives us that example, when he reads Isaiah 61:2, it stops in the middle.
Remember, that's how we started this study. When Yeshua read Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 2.
2a.
2a. He stops right in the middle. And that's why we remember? That was kind of the whole premise of us taking this approach, is that it's the prophecies are interwoven. The first part of it and the last part of it all stuck together, and it's our job to figure it out.
So has to come and try to bring peace first.
Yes.
And
how do we know that? Because of the feasts. Because of the feast, remember, that's why we knew, that's how, that was the sort of the key that unlocked Isaiah 1, verses 1 and 2a, and why there's a separation between 2a and 2b and the rest of that, right? The whole, because of the feast, remember?
The feast has to tell us where we're at.
That's right, it's the talk, and so when you look at the spring feast, you see a lamb dying. Bingo! You know that that's a picture of the one who comes to suffer for everyone, right? So every prophecy that is of a Messiah who is humble, who is peaceful, who is loving, who is compassionate, every prophecy of Scripture about Messiah like that will be fulfilled right here. Right? And then every prophecy about Messiah, where he's slinging blood everywhere, it's going to be right here. And right here.
And so we were talking about Yehuda, why he got the scepter, and why he's going to be the lawgiver and stuff. And we went to this just now about how do you know Yeshua came first to bring peace. We said it was peace, and just like what I think Mike just said, you know, they tell us where we're from, they tell us where we are, and Teshuva, things like that, they tell them where we're going. So it makes sense that Yehuda, being contrived heart, knows what forgiveness looks like, can see the past, can see where he is, can see the future.
There you go.
Somewhat.
That
everything is wrapped up in the peace, and everything is wrapped up in the Shevet or the Shabbat, and how we live day to day with one another and the Elohim.
That's right. Absolutely. The feasts, I said this at the beginning of this study, I have tried to see prophecy from all these other perspectives out there, and that's why I quit reading these guys, because even some of the Messianic Jewish ones who publish books don't see it through this lens. And I believe they're wrong. And I believe we're going to see them be wrong. Okay? We've already seen it. And I'm not pumping myself up. I'm pumping this up. this understanding of, do you understand what I'm getting at? There were times, that's right, there were times when so-called prophets made doomsday prophecies, and I was confidently able to stand there and say, it is a lie. And these are people who have television stations and you know, connections to the government, and you know, they got all kinds of stuff I ain't got. You're close. But you get what I'm driving at. I believe that this is the map, and it unlocks being able to see into the future. And what Deanne just said is absolutely right. It's the contrition of Yehuda that gave him the ability to do what he did and to become the messianic line.
The community, if you already talked about this, but
I might.
I was trying to do some catch up, and I was reading about, like, you know, how Yeshua talks about, you know, how the summer is close.
We're going to get into that.
Okay.
We're going to get into that. Just wait on that, because that's coming pretty soon.
Oh.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Question.
Sure.
Going back to the verse right before where it says the scepter should not turn to you to. Or the scholar from between his feet. And then it says, until Shiloh comes. With that until there, it's like he's saying the scepter won't depart. When Shiloh comes, something else is going to happen. You see what I'm saying?
Well,
that's what it seems like it's saying. Okay.
Right. So what is Shiloh? You could say that Shiloh then is the city that comes down at the end of the book of Revelation. Okay.
It's a picture of the sun.
It is, but
because I think another literal translation is until Shalom.
Well, the Shalom is wrapped up in it, and that's what I'm getting at, but you don't even have Shalom right here. There's a war.
Right.
Right at the end of the millennium. So if it can't be here is what I'm getting at. I know what you're saying.
Look at
the double
donkeys.
Double donkeys. Two for one.
I'm just so glad that didn't come from me.
But when we get here, Ken, when we get here, everything changes. And there's, you know, there's a new heaven and a new earth. There's, there is no need for, because we've all been taught at that point. So there's no need for him to rule by a scepter at that point. And so I believe that, yes, this is a picture of Messiah, and I said that, until the one who is his comes. But I also believe that it's talking about Olam Haba, the age to come, which is after this. This is not, a lot of people get this mixed up. When Yeshua comes back to earth, that's not Olam Haba. That's still Olam Hazeh, this age, this world. Okay? Olam Haba, the world to come, is after this. And so I believe that's what Shiloh is in reference to, is the world to come. And at that point, he no longer needs a scepter because we've been taught. We have him inside of us, we're resurrected. See, we'll get into this, but briefly, his priesthood will be resurrected here. Everybody else will be resurrected here. Okay? So, a lot of people will be resurrected here. After the priesthood, but then at the end, everybody is resurrected. The ones who died during this time frame and the wicked who didn't rise here, okay, they all rise here, they're judged. He's getting law, he's being a lawgiver at that point, judging the people who rejected him and his truth. And then they're put out into outer darkness, into forgetfulness and forgotten. He creates a new heaven and a new earth, and I believe that's what it's talking about. So the I is up until that one right there.
And also, because this is talking about Messiah, and I can never remember the address for this, but remember at the very end, because this is all about Messiah, who brings everything under subjection, under his feet. Everything's brought to subjection under his feet. And then at that point, he turns it all over up. The Father, so that he can be all in all. That's at that point, his job is.
Yeah, because here, we're going to rule with him while Messiah is on earth. Here, we're going to rule in a new city, and Elohim the Father and Yeshua are sitting in the middle of that on a throne. So will be in the very presence of the Creator at that point. At this point, we're in the presence of His Son, Messiah, Yeshua. Hopefully, all of us will be in resurrected bodies governing this world, and the people who come through the tribulation, and those who are born during this time.
Because I cannot be where any sin is.
That's right. He will not come here as long as there's sin, and there's still sin during this time. There's still nations that are going to not come up for the feast.
There's still going to be people with blood running through their bodies too.
Huh?
They're not paid.
Absolutely. That's the point. That's who the priesthood rules over. That's who the bride rules over with Messiah, is those who are still mortal. It's not until the end that everyone becomes immortal, and everyone's this final decision is made, and they either make it into the new heaven and new earth, or they go into forgetfulness. Okay, I've got to get your mail first, then I'll go speak. Somebody over here. Angela. Okay, Matt.
Can you explain forgiveness to me? Because I asked you about that.
No, not today. we'll get to it.
In Genesis 49, verse 10, it says the Shevet will not depart from Yahweh. And so that's the word for staff.
That's right.
There's another word,
Mate,
which is used for staff
tribe. Tribe.
And like in the story of Tamar,
Shevet is also used for tribe in places.
When Tamar is talking with Judah, she says, you know that staff in your hand? And she uses the mate.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, what's the difference between these two words?
I don't think there's...
Mate.
Well, I don't think that there is a difference, but I think it's a link more than it is a distinction.
Okay.
A link.
Okay.
Because there are other scriptures where mate is... And this is kind of a clue word, just like Asaf was. Mate and Shevet are both clue words about the rulership of Messiah. So I think what Mate does is it might not take us to this prophecy, but it will take us into some of the Psalms. And we're going to look at a whole bunch of those. We're in the Psalms. I don't know if you guys know it, but the Psalms are largely prophecy. It's very prophetic. Yeshua quotes one of them when he's hanging on the tree that was written about him. Right? Okay, so the Psalms have a whole bunch of prophecy about all this stuff in it as well. It's all intermixed and interwoven in there, and what we're doing is using the map to try to pull these out and set them all into place. Angela. I would use both.
To me, lay it can be, you know, those first two services when we look on the board of where the site was. You know, kind of you need to see the board, you need to come back. So.
Absolutely.
Like both?
Yeah. Is that a question, Mike, or are you just revising?
No, but
the answer is yes.
We need to speak up, though, because
I'm not sure I understood the question.
Yeah.
Okay, do we think that Rab Lav, which actually means feet, she said legs, but feet, is literal or figurative? And if it's figurative, then it could these be it? Absolutely. But I do believe it's also literal, because what did Israel see when they looked up at the mountain?
His feet.
They saw his feet.
Yeah, and it should be right at the very beginning of this whole conversation, that you're asking about the feet. I was digging, trying to find the reference I was looking for. I mean, the feet is symbolic of the sign also. I mean, so Isaiah 52:7, I'll be for the mountains of feet, those who bring good news. I mean, that's, and then Nahum, I found another reference, Nahum, one of the look on the mountains of feet, the one who brings good news and peace. I mean, the feet are symbolic of the sign, so it's a step there.
Well, I would say it's symbolic more of the Besorah than it is of the Messiah himself. You know what I'm saying? Not the person, but his kingdom.
Okay.
Because that's exactly what happens. Because one of the apostles quotes that when talking about the Besorah, and that word there, who brings good news, that's Besorah. That's gospel. Okay, so. Yes, the Rab Lav, he, you know, you ever heard the phrase, put feet in your faith?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
it's the armaments, isn't it?
Yeah. feet are shod with the preparation of the vessel rod. That's right. Okay, so I'm going to skip Zebulun and Issachar and look at Dan. Dan will avenge his people. The tribes of Israel will be united as one. Dan will be a serpent on the highway, a viper by the path that bites a horse's heels so its rider falls backward. For your Yeshua do I long, O Yahweh. The reason I'm skipping the other two is because they're minor tribes, and the rest of the tribes are minor tribes, but this one, I believe, has some pretty significant, possibly, I'm still studying but I believe that it is possible that the anti-Messiah will be a Danite.
Yes. Praise Yahweh.
Reason that I believe it is because of what it says here. He has to be a Jew. Which means he has to be from Judah. He has to claim lineage from David. So I believe that he will either be actually descended from both Dan and Yehuda, or he will be a Danite who is posing as a Jew.
Liar, so.
Exactly.
Is that why it's not, he's not there at the end in Revelations, and then he's got it up?
No, the reason he's not there at the end is because of what Dan and Ephraim did in right before the time of these three prophets right here.
Okay.
So Israel split, I'll be brief. Israel split into two kingdoms. The northern kingdom was ruled by an Ephraimite.
Right.
The two most powerful tribes in the northern kingdom were Ephraim and Dan. And each of those tribes built a counterfeit temple of Elohim in their lands. One over here and one over here. And in those temples, which they called temples of Yah, they put a golden calf and called that golden calf Yahweh. So they did the same thing their ancestors did at the base of the mountain while Moshe was up getting the Torah. They did the exact same sin. They called this golden calf Yahweh. They mixed the worship of the Creator with all the worship that was going on around them. And because of their persistent rebellion, they are forgotten. He says, I will forget you. And this is why, I'm going to state it again, this is why we are not, in any form or fashion, a two-house congregation. When we get visitors in here and they start talking, if they say, Brother Judah, watch out. That's two-house language. They talk about Judah in a semi-derogatory manner because they think that they are Ephraim. They think that they're Ephraimites. It never ceases to amaze me that the two-house movement is riddled with people who say they're from Ephraim and Dan. And they're the two tribes forgotten, left out of the tribal census in Revelation chapter 7, I believe. That's our parsha this week. Yeah, that's our parsha this week. So yeah, those are the two tribes that are left out. Why? Because they sinned the great sin that their fathers committed at the mountain, and they would not repent. And Allah told them, I will forget you. Okay? I'll try to get back to you if I don't break it again. Why do I believe that a Danite might be the anti-Messiah? Because of this prophecy, because of another prophecy about Dan, because of his behavior that he exhibited that we just talked about. And because of the location that Daniel gives us of the anti-Messiah, he comes out of the beast that rises out of the sea. And that beast in Revelation 13 is made up of four kingdoms that are here today. Okay, so we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, but that's Iran and Iraq, Turkey, which includes ancient Greece. Okay? Syria. That area right there is the superpower that is about to rise. It's happening right before your eyes. The foundation of it is happening right before. I've said it for years and people have mocked me.
Ain't no way it's going to rise up and be powerful.
Watch.
There's 10 nations.
You ever heard of how much money they have?
There's 10 nations now on both sides of Israel, from Iraq all the way up around to Spain, that have already started trying to create preliminary pacts between them.
I ain't worried about them. I'm talking about Iran, Iraq, Syria, Turkey, Greece.
Yeah.
The Mesopotamian Basin.
Yeah.
That's who you look at. Now, they will govern all the other nations, so those nations do have play. But them I'm not so much worried about.
Yeah.
But what I'm talking about is the beast that rises out of the sea is that people group. And they are already talking about unification.
Is it possible in that they're talking, that the prophecy is talking about the Mediterranean Sea?
Of course it is.
It's got to be. It's
exactly what it's talking about. But more it's talking about peoples. When it talks about seas like that, it's talking about people.
I thought specifically Gentile people, nations too, right? No.
Well, they're all other nations.
Huh?
Yeah. Gentile nations.
Okay. And rising out of the sea, I thought was a Lydian and then Gentile nation.
Yeah. So back to Dan. Why Dan? And this, we're summarizing this. I'll come back to it probably at some point in the future. And I haven't forgotten the answer. In the first century, a letter was written to Israel from some Greeks. And they said, "We are the tribe of Dan." And Josephus tells us that they wrote back and said, "Yeah, we know you are." And that people group are the Spartans. And so, if you know anything about Spartan history, you know that they are a ferocious people.
Warrior nation.
Warrior nation. One of, to me, guys like me and Lance, they are some fascinating people because their strength is ridiculous. We know their diet secrets. But it fits the mold because of the nations that this guy comes out of. In particular, he comes out of the leopard. And the leopard is Greece. And so if you check, there is still a large Jewish community in Greece. That's why I said he might either claim to be Jewish or actually be, because he could be a Greek Jew, if you will. I got to get to him. I owe him. Lance.
Real simple. The name Dan means judge.
It does.
And if he judges falsely as a false messiah, which
is exactly what he says.
Asatan, who is the accuser. Who
is Did you catch that he's called the serpent here?
Yes, yeah.
Nahash.
Okay, Nahash, that's right.
So I asked you a question about maybe 4 studies ago, after study was done.
Oh, Lord.
And I said,
yes.
And so there's the answer.
Yes, absolutely. There are wicked Jews.
That are plotting some of these things alongside, and watch what the other man's doing because this can't really do this.
Yeah.
Does that?
Absolutely. It goes on in our government. Some of our president's top twisted people were Jews. But the issue is that most people look at that and say, all Jews are bad. All Jews are deceived.
So when I say that, I'm thinking,
I know.
That's a pretty volatile thing.
Well, it's tricky. It's tricky for a guy like me. I think about it when I go out. I'm wondering, should I be packing? I'm licensed to pack. And I do sometimes. But I see how people look at me sometimes. I see their vitriol, and I say a word, and I usually go. But they're being more bold, and the reason that they are doing it is because of a handful of Jews who are wicked, who do disobey the scriptures, and they pay no attention to God whatsoever because they're mad at God for all the things that have happened in the past. So they're doing their dead level best to join the world.
George Soros.
And in order for Yisrael, the people of Israel, to accept anyone as Messiah, he has to at least convince them that he's Jewish. Right?
Yeah.
So, and that's the way of it. I mean, look at our country. Obama convinced everybody that he's a citizen.
Right.
I don't believe he is. I think the proof is there, but nobody's willing to look at it. Look how dumb people are when they see someone they think is going to make it all better. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what the anti-Messiah is going to do, is make it all better. You know? So, where are we?
17, verse...
Huh?
16, verse 16.
Okay, yeah. I want to jump back up now to verse, we got 30 minutes. He will launder his garments in wine and his robe in the blood of grapes. So if you go back to Isaiah 61, where this whole thing started, that's what Yeshua read when he stood in his own hometown synagogue and read from the Torah when it was his turn to read. It was his time to be a believer. Now, I believe that means it was his birthday, the anniversary of his birth. It was his parsha. He stood up to read and he read that verse and a half and he stopped. What follows is Ve'yom Nakam Le'Elohenu, the day of the vengeance of our God. There's that duality in the Messiah, coming as someone who comes to heal, to bind up broken hearts, to set captives free, to loose those who are bound.
Amen.
All that good stuff. That's what he's doing right now. That's what's been going on for the last 2,000 years. Is he's been doing that through his people for the last 2,000 years, right? Huh?
Correct.
Okay. And then he says, Ve'yom Nakam Elohim, the day of the vengeance of our Elohim. And this prophecy goes on. We don't have time tonight to look at all of it, but look over at verse chapter 63. Who is coming from Edom with sullied garments from Bozrah? This one who is majestic in his raiment, girded with his abundant strength. It is I who speaks with Tzedakah, abundantly able to say, why is there red on your clothing? Why are your garments like those of someone treading in a wine vat? Sound familiar? Okay. And then, if you go over to Revelation 19, you see that this happens when Yeshua comes back. Okay? But, so you have the Besorah announced, and you have 2,000 years of him binding up broken hearts, setting captives free, healing the sick, all that kind of stuff has been going on for 2,000 years. And somewhere in our future is Yom Nakam Elohenu, the day of the vengeance of our God. I told you we would eventually zero in on a single day. That's the day we're going to zero in on. But in reality, it really is this day right here. Okay? The day of the vengeance of our God. Yom Nakam Elohim. That's not a word, that's an acronym. The day of the vengeance of our Elohim. Because he exacts vengeance beginning here and finally here. And the scriptures say, this is what is so wrong with, I'm sorry, I just don't have another word to use. This is what is so wrong with Christian theology that the day of the Lord is Sunday. That is so untrue. It's not even, it can't even possibly work. This is the day of Yahweh. That's why we label it here the Lord, but they're quoting the verse. Okay? They're quoting multiple verses, and we're going to look at all of them. The day of Yahweh. And that day, you're going to find out, has dual nature, just like the Bessel Rod does. Right? In some places, it's described as a day of peace and safety, and in some places, it's described as a day of war and blood and all this kind of stuff.
Why? Well, it is.
Because it is. It's both. It starts here, and immediately, it's both. Because those who have prepared themselves as a bride who is intimate, who is pure, they go into the chuppah. They go into the wedding chamber. They go become intimate with Messiah and begin to rejoice. And at the same time, everybody else on earth begins to go through bloodshed. Okay? So immediately it has a dual nature. And then for 7 years on earth, things are bloody, things are ugly, worse than they will ever be. I kid you not, sometimes my family is scared to death when I open my mouth and say things like I said a couple of weeks ago. You're going to start seeing major, major earthquakes. Bam! Nepal happens twice!
And it's a concentrated area of Muslims, Buddhists, and what other?
Hindus. Yes. And the nations that are around the Ring of Fire are right now consorting with one another about creating, standing opposed to Israel, exactly. And that's where all these earthquakes are going to start popping off. And I promise you, you're going to see things that you formerly have only seen in movies. They're going to look ridiculous. They're going to look like, oh my gosh, this is not going to be the 1900 earthquake that hit San Francisco. This is going to be some earth, you know. It's going to be crazy.
Well, they got a better one now. It should be in a theater near you soon. No, seriously, they got a new one out.
I know, but...
yeah, San Andreas or whatever.
Yeah, I don't pay attention to that stuff. The earthquake that hit Nepal caused the Himalayas to sink by 3 feet. Did you see that? The whole mountain range sank by 3 feet. They've been watching Yosemite start to swell. It's gone up by, what, 10 inches in the last couple of years, 2 or 3 years?
Yeah.
That means that it's like a zit. It's about somebody's... pushing all that pressure. The skin's starting to rise. We may or may not see some of that. We're going to look at that next week, probably, when we start looking at Yeshua's words. But what I wanted you to see here is this prophecy about Yehuda is coming to pass in the Messiah, where he first teaches for 2,000 years. He sends out us to do his work, the Ruglal, his feet, to do his work, to bind up broken hearts and stuff like that. It goes on for 2,000 years. And then the day of the vengeance of Elohim comes. And that's this whole day in the world. But it does get down specifically to a single day in this little circle right here when it begins, when it almost becomes final right there. Okay, thoughts?
Excuse me.
Sure.
So you say we're going to be here from that point, the
major I said we're probably right about there. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, the reason is, and you missed this, and that's okay. Each of these brackets represents, each of these spaces between the brackets represents 1,000 years in our history. Okay? So this is creation right here. 1,000, 2,000, you get to Noah. Well, actually, Noah's right here. You get to Abraham here. You get to the kingdom of Israel right here. You get to the Messiah, this is where Yeshua came. And then when you get here, you're 2,000 years out. So this was 2,000 years ago. This is 0 AD or 1 AD. Let me put it in 1 AD. Right here. Okay, so we're in 5775 according to the Jewish calendar, but you had to add, you have to add at least 200 years, we know that. So we're at least in 5975. But it could be more than that. So we're somewhere between 6,000 and we're somewhere between there. We just don't know.
In his word, when the Bible talks about the birth pains that are increasing.
I believe 100% that we're there. We're in the birth pains of the Messiah.
Yes.
And that's, yeah, so the labor has started. The bride in Revelation, the woman in Revelation 12?
Yes.
12, who gives birth in Revelation 12, that's us. And I believe that she is in labor right now. Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
I think that 2017 is looking real good for us. What you got?
Kind of a twofold question. One, is it possible, in your estimation, that the counterfeit Messiah, the Antichrist, could be an Arab, just masterpiece? And
no, he won't be an Arab.
He
will be a Muslim.
Okay.
There's a difference.
Okay. He will be a Muslim.
He will be a Muslim.
Okay. And in your estimation, would he be now at this time?
Alive?
Somewhere in the political.
If he is, he's probably behind the scenes, but okay. Yes, his picture is in the pot. Absolutely.
Muslim but not Arab.
Muslim but not Arab. Arabs are the brothers of Israel, and I believe that they are going to have a war that will end up uniting them.
And the Jordanians would be Arabs?
They're the closest Arab brothers to Israel. The Jordanians are Edom, the sons of Esau. Remember the Jacob and Esau?
Exactly, yes.
That's the Jordanians. So they're Israel's closest brother. And they've always been, among the Arab nations around them, they've always been the most accommodating to Israel, even though they have spit in their face a few times. But they've always been, when I flew to Oman and wanted to go to Israel, I had to fly to Jordan first to get there, because Jordan is friendly with Israel, and they let me fly in from there. So yes, all of the Arab nations immediately, and I'm being very specific about Arab nations. I'm talking about Saudi Arabia, Jordan, you could even say parts of Egypt, Lebanon, and
not Syria.
They're not Arabs.
UAE, Yemen, those places.
All those minor ones down there, they're basically lieges of Saudi Arabia, yes. That whole Arabian Gulf, all the nations there, yes.
Because each one is going to have 12 sons, right? And they also have 12 kings, aren't they?
So I do believe that the anti-Messiah will be a Muslim. That's what I believe we're seeing rise up over there is the...
How can you be from Dan?
You don't know how many Muslims are in... Greece? Greece is very Muslim.
I know, but how can...
Because he's the great unifier. He doesn't care about religion. He's going to claim to be a Muslim. He's going to claim to be a Jew. He's going to claim to be a Catholic, a Christian. He's going to unite all religions.
Would he have to have a... In a sense, to identify with people who are purist in that and can accept in him through that, wouldn't he have had or show that some type of bloodline of loyalty?
He'll claim it.
I mean, or he would claim that?
He'll claim it somehow.
Okay.
I'm telling you,
he'll
fabricate it. People are so susceptible to lies these days, it's unbelievable. And it's not beyond the realm of possibility in my mind that he'll just fabricate it. I honestly believe that's what our president is. He just fabricated it. And everybody just bought it, you know, because there's a spirit behind all of this. There is a spirit of deceit that is behind all of this. And if you don't have the rules of God in you, you will be deceived. And so there are believers who will be deceived. And do you know that Elohim says he is the one who's going to deceive them himself?
That's right.
No.
He
He will force them, because they pretended to walk with him while the ruler was here. He said, I will force them to believe the lie and condemn themselves. So Elohim will deliberately blind their eyes to the anti-Messiah and make them, because what is the lie? The lie is that guy is God. They're going to believe it. He's going to do miracles. He's going to have a silver tongue. He's going to be beautiful. In all probability, he's going to woo the leaders of the world. If you get all the leaders behind you, then it's easy to woo the people.
Going
to
be a theocracy no matter what.
Yeah. So, and yes, he will unify all world religions. He says he exalts himself above everything that is called God. We're going to get into these scriptures in detail at a later point, but yes. So I do believe he will be able to.
I just, one question concerning bloodlines and things of that nature. Is it biblical or rabbinical when they say that a person is considered a Jew if your mom is a Jew?
It's rabbinical.
That's rabbinical.
It's rabbinical. Yeah. And that being the case, he will probably have a Jewish mother or a Jewish grandmother, because I was sitting, I've told this story before, but probably not to this group, but in my old job, I worked at Oxy downtown, or down at Permian 59. I used to go for a walk at lunch, and there was this old Jewish man who was always walking around, and I went into the hotel. I forget what hotel it is. We were connected to this hotel in Greenway Plaza, and I went to the hotel lounge just to pray. So I go in there and I pray. The lounge is kind of in a horseshoe shape. So I'm over on this side of the horseshoe praying, and I get up and I start to walk around the other side. There sits this old Jewish man reading his Tanakh. And I walk up to him and I say, at the time, my tzitzit were worn inside. I didn't wear them out because Oxy was a bit snooty, you know. I don't think I wore a kippah to work at that time. But I saw him, and he and I had already talked. And I think, no, he didn't know I was Jewish at the time. So I walk up to him and I said, what are you doing? He says, so I'm reading the Tanakh. So I said, may I? And I pick it up and I read to him. And his is all Hebrew, there's no English in it. And I pick it up and I read to him, and he said, are you Jewish? I said, well, and I was nervous about it. This was the first Jewish person that I really talked to about it. And I was nervous about saying I was, because I know how that can be. You know. So I said, well, my grandmother is. He said, well, then you're Jewish. Because in their mind, if you have four grandparents buried in a cemetery a couple of generations back, or two that generation, or your parents are both Jewish, or one of your parents is Jewish, then your mother is Jewish, and you're Jewish, but they really like it to come from the female line. That is rabbinical. Because you see multiple times, Jacob married two women who were, or had sons through two women who were outside the tribe of Israel, right? Were they not Jewish? Well, technically they weren't, because they weren't from the tribe of Judah. But they were Israeli. They were inheritors in the kingdom. You with me? So I believe that it is rabbinic and it doesn't apply. But Israel today will not accept him unless he has that pedigree. So in all likelihood, one of his mothers, if you will be Jewish. Okay, we've got a few minutes left.
Your earlier guess at the year 2017 is based on a Jubilee from the Six-Day War, I guess?
No. Not at all.
It wouldn't be 50 years from 1967.
I know. That's a happy coincidence.
Where are you getting that from?
Huh?
So where are you getting that
from? I'm getting it from the Yovel of 70 AD, and the Yovel being in 2020, and the seven years splitting the difference between either side of the Yovel. Because it's from 70 AD to 2020 is, I believe it's 40-50s.
Okay. You're still counting.
Which is very
interesting. 70 AD.
40 is a biblical generation, 50 is a Yovel. Alright, so from 70 AD to 2020 is 40-50s. I believe that that's what, I can't prove it because they haven't released his writing yet, but I believe that that's what Isaac Newton was on to when he concluded 2063. He didn't have all the information we had. It could be 2063, with 2070 being a new bell. But I'm kind of that way. God forbid it goes that long. I hate to see. I'm an old man. Seeing the kids of that age and their behavior, oh my God. Yeah, I mean,
2067 through 2073 would be exactly 2,000 years after the war that came through Israel. Right? So I can see a lot of, I said that at the beginning class, I can see a lot of people freaking out. I'm probably going to be alive by then.
I do want to clarify that. I'm not saying he's coming in 2017. I'm just saying it looks better than any other year right now. And what I'm talking about is the blast of that shofar that we'll eventually get to. Okay, we've got a few minutes. Let me see if we want to do this. Give me just a second.
I think last time we did this, we also looked at the list of the names that were in Deuteronomy 33. I was Simeon and Issachar looked out of that. I don't know if that means in the list of that. There you go.
It probably does. I'd have to look at my notes to see.
But the three lists are here. The one we're looking at here in Genesis, Deuteronomy 33, and Revelation 7. And all, both of them have two names that are different.
Yeah, I'll let you know. Right now, however, we found the right chapter. Okay, yeah. Numbers chapter 24. He declaimed his parable and said, the words of Bilam, son of Beor, the words of the man with the open eye of the Supreme One, who sees the vision of Shaddai while fallen and with uncovered eyes. I shall see him, but not now. I shall look at him, but it is not near. A chochav will come forth from Yaakov. A star will issue from Yaakov. And a scepter bearer has risen from Israel, and he shall pierce the nobles of Moab and undermine the children of Seth. Edom, that's who we just talked about, Jordan, the modern nation, shall be a conquest, and Seir shall be the conquest of his enemies, and Israel will attain success. One from Yaakov shall rule and destroy the remnant of the city. He saw Amalek and declaimed his parable and said, Amalek is the first among the nations, but its end will be eternal destruction. He saw the Kenite and declaimed his parable and said, strong is your dwelling and set in a rock is your nest. For if the Kenite should be laid waste, till where can Assyria take you captive? He declared, this is before Assyria really existed as a power, that this prophecy was being made. He declaimed his parable and said, "Oh, who will survive when he imposes these? Big ships from the coast of Kittim will afflict Assyria and afflict the other bank, but it too shall be forever destroyed." Acharit Hayamim. So that happens. This could not have happened before here, right? And I promise you it hasn't happened yet because those nations that we talked about still exist. But that's what I was getting at when asked his question. Is it all those nations around Israel? That's what this is talking about. Okay? These are his brothers. These are the nations right surrounding them, the Arab nations that we're talking about. And in the last days, Israel destroys them. I believe we're seeing that begin to play out right now.
Well, I was just, when you said that, when you read that, I saw people who are in Israel who claim that the land is theirs. I saw them being
taken out. That's right. It is a possibility. I have to be careful to distinguish between what is my desire and what is going to happen.
But it's not your desire because Baba says, well,
it could be.
The land has to be clean.
It will. So let me finish my statement and then we can talk about it. The
goyim are trampling.
That's right.
Cannot be.
That's right. The possibility exists that, and I believe it strongly, but I, like I said, I have to check myself and make sure it's just not my desire.
Go kill some Arabs.
Is that there will come a war between all these nations that were just listed and Israel very soon and before this day. Because is it still, if it happens before here, is it not still in the Acharit Hayamim?
Uh-huh.
Yes, it is. And so, we're going to look at another scripture that echoes this prophecy and spreads it out. So, and it says basically the same thing, and it will blow your mind, because it's like reading today's newspaper. So, I do believe that it's possible that what we're seeing right now, the uprising of all these Arab nations around Israel, and they're joining together, trading arms and all, you know, the bad seed over there taking over, I believe that it is going to cause a war, probably pretty soon. And I'll tell you this, if that happens, our economy's going But Israel will win. Israel will be victorious, and Israel will become the Israel of promise. They will own from the Nile to the Euphrates, like Abba promised Abraham 4,000 years ago. And I think we can see that very soon. Because if Israel, it's already, if you pay attention to Israeli newspaper and newspapers from the other side of the world and not our idiotic journalists, then you see that... You already have read statements about Muslims saying we cannot defeat them, their God fights for them.
Amen.
That happens in every Israeli war. And even today, that we, you know, every other week it seems some Muslims saying it's just useless. We're not going to defeat them. Because it does say that prophecy that we will look at says very specifically that they will be handily defeated by Israel and by Abba. They will know, and they will come to glorify their God.
The
Nizal? Yes.
There will be a sign
of the end times near, right? That's one of the signs of the end times. Yes. Absolutely. Imagine it before? No. It's probably alluded to in there, but not the specific prophecy. Okay, any other thoughts or questions?
I got one.
Alright,
maybe
I'll answer this one.
Can I ask a question about Dan or
what? Go ahead and answer.
It is
It's about Zechariah 12, because you're talking about the Antichrist again. It was his name like around Bashan, or something like that.
I'd have to look.
Okay. Because I heard that before from somebody talking
about strongholds of Bashan, I believe it is.
Zechariah 12 talks about like welling coming from Bashan, and God watching like a shepherd in the land who's like an evil shepherd.
It was, I'd said earlier, it was the Dana that said that Messiah came in the fold of God. Exactly.
I thought you were wrong about that.
Yeah.
I was 100% sure.
Yeah.
I was like, can you read the thing? It's only been a couple months since I read Daniel.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, is that all?
Yeah.
Being Mount Daniel, Father, our King, in the name of Messiah Yeshua, we give you thanks for your Torah, your word, cover to cover. Thank you for your Ruach and for the feasts, which help us to interpret it. We do ask, God, that you show us only truth, and that we not become arrogant about it, but that you help us to prepare our hearts for what is coming. Help us to bring other people into your kingdom, to be obedient, to be loving toward you and obedient to you, that they may be ready. We ask you, God, that you increase our tent for that purpose, the size of our tent. We thank you for it. We just ask that you be with us until the Shabbat, and we assemble around your throne. Help us clean up.